They find the money, like, kind of difficult. Then we get lots of residents here.
So, okay, so it's great to have Scott here to give us a talk on Tensor Graph extended by the tribe of politics.
Thanks. I think I haven't talked about this before at ANU. I can't quite remember because this is actually work from maybe 2 or 3 years ago, and it's possible that I've talked about it, but I don't think I have. If it feels boring, shout, I'll stop or something. So what was the point of this project? So the point of this project was just in some sense that monodal categories or tensor categories are hard and confusing, and while we have little microscopic views of what's going on, we would really like to know a lot more. And so far we're sort of struggling in saying much about what the examples out there look like. And so this was sort of yet another project in a sequence of projects that I've tried over the years to find a new microscope and look a tiny, tiny distance in some different direction than we previously looked in the space of all tensor categories and see what we can see. Maybe I should be slightly more encouraging than that. Today we're going to talk about some very particular class of tensor categories, or these ones, whatever this phrase, generated by a trivalent vertex, which I'll explain in just a second. But in some sense also this project was sort of a first attempt to develop techniques to automate studying skein theory. So skein theory, means different things to different people, but for me today, it's going to mean something like when you look at some class of graphs drawn on the plane, and maybe they've got vertices of some particular sorts, and then you have some linear relations amongst local pieces of these graphs. For example, you might have a relation that says that, say we're studying four-valent graphs, there might be some relation that says anytime you see this diagram, you can replace it with some linear combination, maybe with some interesting coefficients of other things. And because, of course, you can, when you're studying now planar graphs, if you have some relation that you're allowed to apply anywhere inside that graph, there are lots of consistency conditions. If I just write down some stupid relation like I recommended here, you shouldn't expect it to give you anything, because you should think that, well, it might be pretty easy to find some graph for which it's possible to apply the relations you've got in two different ways and get two different answers, and the whole thing you've just written down was just nonsense. So it turns out that studying skein theories in the general sense of planar graphs modeled on some collection of vertices with some collection of local relations are extremely constraining, and it's hard to find study examples. You can't just write down anything and get something. So while this project is all about this idea of generated by a trivalent vertex, throughout everything we do here, we're trying to do everything sort of uniformly and with, to some degree, our hands tied behind our backs to make sure we're using techniques that can go and study lots of other skein theories. Maybe I'll say a little bit more about that later. Okay. So first of all, there's a word left off the title, which I better put there, which is that we're going to be interested in pivotal categories. So pivotal categories here, this just means nodal categories, categories with tensor products, but further with really nice duals. So here, every object X has some dual object. It's got the sort of maps you might expect from doing linear algebra, a map from dual tensor X back to the tensor unit. Similarly, a map the other way from 1 to XX dual. And the final bit that Pivotal adds is these duals behave really like duals in finite dimensional vector spaces, that we've got some particular isomorphism we love between X and X double dual for real. Now, that's all a bunch of algebraic nonsense, and for people who know it, it's great. But for the rest of the talk, it's completely irrelevant, because another way of saying pivotal category is just that, is just saying we can draw morphisms on the board, that is, morphisms in the category represented by some sort of pictures that you can draw on the board, up to planar isotopy. That is, if you take some diagram representing a morphism and slide it around the plane somewhere, you always get exactly the same morphism you started with. And so studying pivotal categories is really actually about studying planar graphs in some sense, because their morphisms are always just graphs drawn on the board up to planar isotopy. So you don't actually need to worry about what any of those words mean. Okay. So before I show you where we go and the theorem we try and prove, let's spend a little while actually just studying an example. So say we have C, a pivotal category, with an object X. Generated in the sense that you can get all of the morphisms by taking tensor products and compositions of this particular morphism, so-called T, from X tensor X to X. So this is our eponymous trivalent vertex. It's got two inputs and one output. And when I say generated, so we're allowed to use our trivalent vertex, but we're also allowed to use the stuff guaranteed by having duals and so on, which means that we're allowed to have cups and caps, because that's how duals in this string diagram interpretation of what pivotal categories are about are just these maps here are just cups and caps. And so, for example, we can make morphisms like this by using the operations of the tensor guy, which just says that all of the home spaces, if we look at home X tensor N, X tensor M, these are the only objects that we can really see from the point of view of this object here, is just, well, let's allow linear combinations, because in the end the goal is to do physics, of planar trivalent graphs. So that's the sort of thing we're studying, and that's more or less most of what I mean by a category generated by a trivalent vertex. Let's start to add some extra conditions that might make it possible to classify a category of this form. So say, let's take a little bit of notation right from the beginning. So let me define C lower K to just be maps in the category from, say, tensor unit to X tensor power K, which really just means that this is just all of the things with all of the linear span of all trivalent graphs with K boundary points. Okay? So suppose.
So far, the home spaces are big infinite-dimensional.
No, that's not quite what I want you to think at the moment. So I want to say that C is some pivotal category generated by this morphism, but it maybe has relations as well. So what you should think is that these home spaces are certainly spanned by that infinite set of all possible trivalent graphs with endpoints and bottom endpoints.
Right. Tell me about relations.
Yeah, but I'm imagining that there are maybe some unknown relations that we need to go and understand. So in fact, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to add some conditions. Like, let's suppose the dimension of C2 is 1, the dimension of C3 is 1, and the dimension of C4 is 2. So here, if we just took all graphs, all these numbers would be infinite, so I'm really, really cutting it down an extremely long way. What can we say here? Well, so a little consequence, for example, of this fact here is that if I look at this little graph here, a little bigon, That's just some scalar multiple of a piece of string. Well, why is that? These are both morphisms in C2, in the sense that they're both planar graphs with two boundary points. And I just assume that's a one-dimensional vector space. So these guys have to be scalar multiples of each other. Now, you might have wondered why, if they're scalar multiples of each other, I get to assume that this guy is non-zero. The problem is, if this guy was zero, then everything would be boring, because our object X, its identity morphism would be the zero morphism. It would be unfun. So we get to assume that a linear relation between two diagrams like this is of this form. Okay. So that immediately says that any time we see, if we put these hypotheses, there's certainly now a spanning set for any Hopf space consisting of graphs that don't have any bigons in them, because I could just use that relation between the bigons. Similarly, if I see a little triangle somewhere, there's a relation of this form, that little triangle with legs. Sorry, that doesn't look much like a triangle, but that's a triangle. It has to be t times the trivalent vertex. So I chose the bad layer t for today. Let's just not give the vertex a name. We won't need a name. What follows? Keep t for that scalar. And then what else? Well, let's see. So in C4, we certainly have these diagrams. So if this vector space is only two-dimensional, there must be some linear relation between them. And let me not worry about the possibility that there's actually a linear relation between these guys.
Scott, when you say these things are in C2, C3, and C4,
are you
using some duality?
Yeah, so technically here I'm meant to draw diagrams with one point at the bottom and k points at the top.
Zero points at the bottom.
Zero points at the bottom and k points at the top. But I'm giving myself already a little bit of flexibility because of the way that I've set up duals. We always have isomorphisms. But that Hopf space is canonically identified with, say, this one, where what I did is I took a map with x and y coming in and z going out, and all that I did was I pulled up the y string from the bottom using the duality. And so it actually doesn't matter whether you put the boundary points on the top or bottom, and I'm just allowing myself to freely move those around. Really, if you want to just forget the category theory interpretation, you should just be thinking that CK is the space of planar trivalent graphs with k boundary points. Just not worry about the source and target, which really is justified by studying visual categories. I did a terrible job here of trying to both say the category theory language and then just use the planar trivalent graphs. Okay. So if the dimension of C4 is only two, and we've got these three diagrams here, we must have some linear relation. As I said, I'm not going to worry about the case where there's a linear relation between these two. It turns out that case is boring and easy to understand. One has to think about that separately. So we get to assume that there's a relation like this.
Because those two don't involve the trivalent vertex, what is that the point? Why is it boring?
It's not so important. There are examples like that. I just don't want to have to talk about them now. There's one very simple example.
Is there one
with
three vertices on top and one on the bottom?
Three vertices on top. Like this? Boundary point? Well, but the point is that whatever the space is here, it's canonically identified with the space here. So you just don't need to worry about the distinction between top and bottom. You can think of all of these graphs as just drawing discs rather than drawing rectangles. Just don't worry about tops and bottoms. So we'd have to have a relation of that form. And from that, we can quickly start deducing quite a lot. Uh, oh, I forgot to.
You want to see one?
Yes. Excellent. Let's also say that the dimension of C1 is 0. Oh, okay. So that is, I just don't want to look at any graphs that have only one boundary point, setting all those equal to 1. And going back to the category theory interpretation, you might think that the reasonable assumption that, imagine if X were a semi-simple category, if X were simple and not the tensor unit, then there wouldn't be any maps from 1 to X, and that would explain why the dimension of C1 is 0. But for now, let's just have it be another one in this arbitrary seeming list of numbers. Okay. So yeah, the consequences we get from this, well, if you've got a relation, you can always apply it inside some bigger graph. And so we get a relation that looks like this. Now, inside this picture, we see something that has one boundary point. So by this hypothesis here, this is actually 0. It's very important for this subject that you undo the invention of whoever it was who invented the numeral 0. And don't use the numeral 0, because this is a loop of string, not the number 0. I keep on forgetting hypotheses here. Let's also have dim C0 being equal to 1, which is just saying there's only one map from 1 to 1, which is a sensible sort of thing from a category theory point of view, but it's also saying that somehow we're thinking about categories where there are enough relations that we can evaluate any closed graph. We can use our relations to rewrite any closed graph as some scalar multiple of the empty diagram, and that's our basis for the C0. Okay. And so here, if we let, so then this circle here is by itself some map from 0 points to 0 points, so that's an element of C0. So it's just a scalar in that one-dimensional space there. So let's introduce a symbol for that and let that be equal to D. And then what have we learned? We learned that alpha plus beta D equals 0. But similarly, we could do another calculation here using the same relation inside a diagram in a different way, close it off on the right, and now we get alpha times this guy plus beta times this guy. Now, we've already decided that this is just V times a piece of string, and then this is alpha D times a piece of string plus beta times a piece of string. Let's make our life a little bit simpler all throughout here by always letting this parameter, the bygone, be 1. Which might seem yet another crazy arbitrary thing that Scott's doing, but it's just something we're doing for convenience. If I had my category generated by a trivalent vertex, I could always think of rescaling the vertex, just changing, replacing it with some multiple of itself. And as long as I'm working over some, well, field or ring or Geiger or whatever, where that number b had a square root, I could have just rescaled my trivalent vertex to change that b into a 1 by changing this guy. So let's just do that, so we don't need to carry b's around everywhere in what follows. And so this gives us another little formula that alpha d plus beta equals 1. And now, we realize that we need to do a little bit more. We still need to do a little bit more. Let's see. So this is just alpha is negative beta d. And plugging this in here, we get beta times 1 minus d squared equals 1. So those are two things we've learned just by studying the consequences of this relation here. And let's fit in one more, squeeze it on the same board. We could also take this relation and stick a trivalent vertex on top of it. Okay. And again, by the previous sorts of arguments, this guy is just zero. This guy, that's just a bygone there, so you can just erase that little loop, and we find there actually alpha equals one, and now hopefully we've got enough to solve. Oh no, sorry. Hopefully this is enough to solve everything. So what have we got at this point? We've got alpha is 1, so beta is negative 1 over d, and this turns into a polynomial in d. Great. And we actually just simplify it out a little bit. This just becomes some, I guess it's, beta is 1 over d, so clear the 1 over d over here, and then collect everything. And you get this little polynomial, d squared minus d minus 1 is 0. So something very peculiar has happened.
Why is alpha 1?
Looking at this equation here, this term is 0 because it's got a monogon in it. And remember, we weren't interested, we said that all diagrams with one boundary point are 0. Inside this, there's a picture with one boundary point, so that's 0. The bygone is 1, so alpha equals 1. Okay. So something a little bit strange happened, I think, already at this point. Just by plugging in some strange list of integers for the dimension bounds here, we got some interesting algebraic integer popping out that is perhaps a little bit surprising. That's, of course, the golden rule.
We can d was the value of the circle?
And d was the value of the circle.
Yeah.
Okay. So this relation then simplified. Oh, let me move it in place. Let me make it. So in fact, we thought we had some relation of this form, and we didn't know alpha and beta, but a very little easy bit of scheme theory gave us the particular form of the relation. Okay, so let's now prove a sort of interesting lemma that we'll use a little later. So there's a unique, non-degenerate, this is a word I need to explain. Pivotal category. Generated by the transmount vertex. Satisfying a relation of this form. Maybe this limit really should say for each alpha and beta, there's at most one non-degenerate pivotal category satisfying a relation of this form. So for a moment we're forgetting actually what the values of alpha and beta are, and we're going to claim that there's a uniqueness theorem here. Merely having a relation like that pins down entirely what the category is. So before I can possibly prove a theorem like that, I need to tell you what non-degenerate means. So this just means for all morphisms in the category from A to B, non-zero, there exists some other morphism back again, V to A, so that what you might call the trace of F times G is non-zero.
Okay.
So this is the definition of non-degenerate in a pivotal category. You need these cups and caps to behave nicely the way they do in a pivotal category. You're going to make sense of this diagram. That's the our notion of knowledge. Roughly, you should be thinking here that,
are you assuming that dim C0 is 1 in the setup for this lemma, or no?
Ah, Yeah, I probably am. There, I'm sure there are some lurking dimension.
So in particular, in this non-degenerate thing, that diagram is really a scalar.
This diagram, yeah. We certainly need dim C0=1. We'll possibly find we'll need some more things if we actually try and prove the scalar. But yeah, the point is that with dim C0=1, all of these closed diagrams are just copies of the field. Why is this true? Well, the slightly more general lemma is that given relations sufficient, to evaluate all closed diagrams, you're unique. That is, if I give you some collection of relations that is sufficient to evaluate all closed diagrams, then there cannot be two different non-degenerate categories, both satisfying that same set of relations. Okay? That's the claim here. And so this lemma is then just meant to be a special case of this, saying that if you've got a relation like this, you can evaluate all closed diagrams. And so let me do that very sketchily. So the point is, maybe we better, so the point is that you can use this to shrink the smallest face. So say you've got some closed diagram, you look in it, you find some face that's big, okay, and then you apply this relation on some edge of that face, and you observe. Actually, you don't even. Sorry, for this one we can just do things much more easily. The point is just that if you've got a closed diagram that's got any trivalent vertices in it, at least two of them are connected. And applying this relation rewrites it in terms of a trivalent graph with fewer vertices, and that lets you run downhill until finally the hypothesis that the dimension C0 is 1 says that if you've got a whole bunch of closed loops, you can evaluate all those as scalars. Okay. So the interesting theorem is this one. Why, if having relations sufficient to evaluate all closed diagrams, you're going to be. Okay. And the lemma that makes this work is that the pivotal category with that is a simple tensor unit, which is just a condition that Hom from 1 to 1, which is what we've been calling C0 for us, is the field. We don't need, it doesn't even need to be semi-simple or abelian or anything to talk about what that means. So a pivotal category with simple tensor unit has a unique maximal ideal. So ideal, I mean here in the pivotal category sense, so you're allowed to compose and tensor product to generate new things in the ideal. And what is this ideal? Well, it's the negligible ideal. And the negligible ideal is just what you might expect from this definition here. It's the set of all f from A to B, such that for all g from B to A, diagram is 0. Okay. So this has got a really easy proof, and then we'll see why this one implies that one. So here, the point is just that, say you've got some morphism in your category F, which is not in the negligible ideal. Okay. Well, that immediately tells you that there is some G that gives you something non-zero in the scalars, which of course just tells you that element of the scalars is in the ideal. Yeah, that's what ideal means.
I'm just missing something easy. I thought by non-degenerate you require no Fs, that for all G, the composition is zero.
Yes, so for this lemma, we haven't assumed anything about non-degenerates. It's all, when we're talking about pivotal categories, they've got a unique maximal ideal and epifields. And this is you're thinking already about this implication. So for now, so if you have something that's not negligible, but is in some ideal, then that tells you that that the scale is, when you were thinking of that as a poem, 1-to-1, are all in the ideal, because we can do this, and that then means that everything is in the ideal. Well, I guess I needed the word proper somewhere in there. Okay. So now 10% of the way through my talk, halfway through the time. How does this imply this? Well, if you've got a so we could look at the pivotal category, the free pivotal category on a trivalent vertex, or whatever vertices I'm looking at, and I can quotient out by the given relations. Okay, that's some pivotal category. So it's got this unique proper ideal, namely the negligibles, and so the only way to get a non-degenerate category from that is to quotient out by the negligibles. Okay, if you didn't quotient out by all the negligibles, you'd still have negligibles, it wouldn't be non-degenerate. And once you've quotiented out by all the negligibles, there's nothing more you could possibly quotient out by, because the negligibles of the quotient will be true. Okay. Sorry if that didn't make you happy. But the takeaway is that, somewhat surprisingly in this world, once you've got enough relations that let you evaluate any closed diagram, any closed graph, you completely pin down what your category is. Okay. And in this case, we have enough relations by that. Okay. Well, there's still a big question, of course. Does such a category exist? We know there's at most one satisfying this relation here, and the general answer here is yes, but it's a bit hard. And usually the way this sort of subject goes is that you go away and hope that someone else has already constructed such a category that fulfills the things that you're looking for at this point. And indeed, sadly, sort of later in this, if I ever get to it, when we get to the corresponding questions for more interesting cases, it's sort of at the one paper per example kind of level of difficulty to actually realize particular scheme theories. You tend to need to do a lot of work, and it's something that is outside the scope of what I'm trying to say today. It's sort of meant to be purely scheme theory. So yes, this thing does exist. It's called the Fibonacci category or the golden category. You can get it from quantum groups at roots of unities. So this is like rep G2 at level 1 or a bunch of other places. So
that's for the particular alpha that came from that D.
Yeah, so what we learned here was that for each alpha and beta, there's at most one category of this form. Uh-huh. In fact, there's none unless alpha equals 1 and beta equals 1 over the golden ratio. And then the fact that people have studied quantum groups in the past realizes that single point. Great. So now we want to get ourselves a little bit out of the bog, and have a bit of a higher view of what we might do in the future.
And the fact that D was not an integer means you can't represent this category.
So this polynomial category is an interesting one. It doesn't have a fibre-functed of vector spaces because the dimensions of objects are non-integers.
Yeah.
Okay. let's think about it this way. So consider F, the free pivotal, maybe to be correct, I need to say spherical there, but let's press on. The free pivotal category on some generators. So that's just like all the planar graphs built out of some collection of vertices. So any quotient, any non-degenerate quotient, this kind of what some pivotal ideal, I don't even need non-degenerate yet. Let's pause there. There's that. What I do need is, suppose we've got some quotient with simple tensor unit, which is another way of saying that this ideal contained enough stuff to evaluate all closed diagrams, that home from 0 points to 0 points became scalar multiples the identity. So a quotient like that gives us a point. Let's take the field we're working over, and let's take one copy of the field for each polyhedron we can build out of the basic vertices that we're thinking about here. Okay? And the point here is just, well, for each polyhedron built out of the vertices, you just evaluate it in this quotient. Okay? So for example, you could, using the relations we had before, because there's a triangle there, that would be equal to t times this guy. I replaced that triangle with just a trivalent vertex. It could be equal to t times b times this guy, removing a bigon. It could be equal to t times b times d. Okay? And that's the value of the tetrahedron component of this vector here. Okay. And the point is, there's at most one non-degenerate category. And now the point is, squeeze it in here, is just that bounds on dim CK cut out varieties in there, in this infinite dimensional thing. And it might not have been particularly clear from the calculation that we were doing over here, where we ended up learning that alpha equals 1 and beta equals 1 over d, how you should think of that as cutting out some variety here. So let me show you how to rethink of the calculation we just did in that way. Okay, so we had those two diagrams, you remember, sitting in C2. But C2 was meant to be a one-dimensional space. So if we look at the matrix of inner products of those two diagrams, so that is, by inner product I mean plugging them both into sort of the pairing that's implicit here, what do I get? If I put in two bits of string in both places, I just get a loop. If I put them in this way, I get a string and then a loop on top, then a bigon on top, and then I close it up. Or here I get the bigon and a bit of string on top, and then I close it up. And over here, I get the sort of double bigon. And of course, because these were two things in a one-dimensional space, we can just look at the determinant of that matrix, and it has to vanish, because, well, these things that we're plugging into the inner product must have some linear relation between them. So the rows or the columns, whatever you like, have to have a linear relation between them. And so you might say that this condition, dim C2 equals 1, is cutting out this little piece of this big space. Okay. So similarly, I dare not move this board, if we could look at these three diagrams we were looking at before, in C4, and again compute this matrix of interference. So maybe I won't draw all of it. I've drawn them in a different order. Oh well. Commute these, keep care about matching up the matrix. And the point is that you can actually just evaluate this using the things that we learned earlier, and you just see that you get here all the entries here are just actually monomials in D, just by repeatedly moving bigons, and so then the determinant equals zero actually says that D cubed times D squared minus D minus one equals zero. It turns out it's impossible to have D equals zero and B non-degenerate, so you can sort of ignore this term and cut out and have this condition that given the C4 is 2 cuts out a very particular point telling you the value, the two different possible values of the loop. That was just another formulation of the same calculation we did a moment ago. Okay, let me at this point draw a giant picture, which will have to suffice for the remainder of the talk instead of actually giving the rest of the talk.
So the point is, if you fix a bunch of dimensions of various CKs,
yeah,
then you get some big variety.
Yeah, and you, in practice, tend to quickly get down to very, very small subvarieties where you can actually, in practice, you quickly get down to a variety which is actually realized by categories at every point over it. This turns out to be quite effective, and you don't need to do that much work doing these sort of determinant calculations before you're down to some subvariety where the points are actually realized by.
Is that just because in practice the CKs typically have very small dimensions? Because
We're being a bit lame and only doing like very, very small numbers. Yeah. Okay. Let me just attempt to draw this picture. I'm meant to now draw a picture of a tree. Okay. If any of you have walked past my office in the last couple of years, you've already seen this picture. I'm going to need both boards at this rate. This is terrible. Okay. But I think we can now at least explain what this picture means. Okay. One more branch up on the left here. So here is the giant tree out here that we know nothing about. And so let me label some branches. So this tiny little branch down here is dim C4, is at most 3. This branch here is dim C4 equals 4. And this enormous branch, which is rightfully the trunk of the tree, is dim C4 is at least 5. So we're kind of bifurcating depending on that. And the very first example that we saw, which we've studied already so far today, was this Fibonacci category that we got down here, where in fact dim C4 was actually 2. It turns out there's one other category that's on this branch. And you could either call it a chromatic polynomial, or you could call it the quantum version of the representation category of SO3. So it's actually a one parameter family of tensor categories, depending on some parameter Q, or depending on the number of colors when you're thinking in terms of the chromatic polynomial. But it's a one parameter family of categories generated by a trivalent vertex, all satisfying that condition. condition. And one can relatively easily prove, similar to the arguments that we gave, that, that there's only this other one-dimensional graph.
Okay. And Q is any complex number?
Yes. I'll draw another picture in just a moment. There are a few special points, and I think I've got enough time to draw that picture too. Okay. So then you go up to dim C4 equals 4, and at the next branch, you look at dim C5, and you say it's either less than 10, or on this branch, bigger than at least 12, and on this branch, exactly 11. And then finally, here, you look at dim C6 is at most 40, dim C6 is at least 41. Let me fill in some things that you get here. Unfortunately, most of the names you might recognize. There's a category we call ABBA. There's all of the quantum group categories coming from the representation category of G2 and its quantum definitions. And this one here, it deserves a separate spot, but it's, what is it? It's just another one of these G2 categories, but it's at a very special spoon of unity and slightly different things happen. And up here you just get a, so these are one parameter families, that's a single point. This is also a single point. I certainly don't have time to talk about it, but this is something discovered only a year or two earlier than we did all of this work. It's a fusion category that's related to the Hargreaves subfactor that we didn't even expect to find actually on this table. We hadn't even realized it was trivalent until we found it there. Okay. If I had much more time, I'd tell you a little bit about the work that goes into studying these branches. Let me tell you a little bit about these branches, however, first. There's certainly stuff off here on this giant tree trunk of the branch. In fact, if you look at any of the complex simple V algebras and look at the representation category, and you think of the trivalent vertex as carrying copies of the adjoint representation and the bracket at the trivalent vertex, that gives you a trivalent category, and they all live off on this branch. There's plenty of things there. There's no shortage of stuff on this branch. And we have no idea whatsoever how we would classify anything out there. On the other hand, with no evidence whatsoever, I would sort of bet that these branches of the tree of life actually go extinct, and that the heuristic is somehow that once you've turned left a few times up the tree of life, you no longer have many options to turn back right again. It would take a lot of convincing before any of you should expect to believe. I think it's true.
You should call it turning wrong.
Okay, so let me. So then the sections of the, this paper that I'm talking about, which is a paper with Emily Peters and Noah Snyder, essentially, after it has sort of some setup, it essentially has three theorems that sort of correspond to proving what happens on that branch, proving what happens on this branch, and studying what happens on that branch. And in some sense, they're all fancy versions of the little argument we gave you for fib, but they get to use a lot of more interesting, both planar graph theory and quite a bit more interesting varieties than the one we met so far, d squared equals d plus 1. So let me show you now the statements of, I think I can do both. I can write the statements of both theorem A and theorem B. Certainly not. And I'll draw then a pretty picture of the varieties that are involved on those branches. So the interesting thing is that on the branches that we need to study here, in fact, the only polyhedra we ever really need to look at are these three here, the values of the tetrahedron, the value of the bigon, and the value of the circle. And really, well, for the general problem, we're really thinking of this big infinite dimensional space, it's actually a little three-dimensional space that lets us do almost all this work. Okay. So theorem A says the off-lead dimension of C4 is at most 3, implies that this polynomial, which we call the SO3 polynomial, just d plus t minus dt minus 2 equals 0. And then C must be equal to SO3 at some root of unity as long as the pair dt is not mysterious point minus 1, 3 over 2, which does lie on that curve, or C is the representation category of this strange orthosymplectic supergroup. Somehow, all of these categories on the sitting over this curve do have a uniform description scheme theoretically, but realizing them from the representation theory, something is really wonky, and you just, the thing that you get from representation theory, you just can't realize one particular point on this curve. But happily, some other representation category fills in that point for you. It's a little peculiar. Now, theorem B says if the dimension of C4 is exactly 4, and the dimension of C5 equals 10, then either the ABA polynomial is actually just t squared minus t minus 1 equals 0, or this other crazy polynomial, which I will not write out. This is just a polynomial that I'm naming. It's this polynomial, which we gave a name.
It's the variety of n.
Exactly, yeah. So we've got, if these are satisfied, if this condition is satisfied, we've got these parameters d and t, the value of the loop and the value of the triangle, those values must satisfy this condition, if you've got that dimension condition. And then we claim that every point on that variety is realized by one of these categories. Okay, so if you satisfy and said dim c4 equals 4 and dim c5 is almost 10, you are sitting on one of these two different varieties. There's about 20 terms in there involving D and T. And these are all realized by, well, I'm just not going to say what that one's realized by, and these ones are realized by ref G2. It's some values of a quantum parameter Q. And in fact, this curve here is rational, and you can parameterize it. You can parameterize it by Q. Unfortunately, the usual quantum group Q gives you a fourfold cover of that, but whatever.
Is one of them D there actually? P Abbott?
P Abbott? Sorry. No, there's no D's in here. So this is a one parameter family where T is one of the golden ratios and D is anything you like. So there's a one parameter family indexed by just an arbitrary D and T is one of two particular values.
But T squared minus T is becoming zero, right?
T squared. Oh, sorry. That T squared is a T. Okay, so let me grab a few pieces of colored chalk and just draw the picture of the three varieties in the DT plane that we've seen so far, because it's a kind of cool picture. And then if you want to know how many of these theorems actually get proved, maybe. So this picture that I'm about to draw has some strange features that I don't really know how to interpret. So I'm going to attempt to draw a picture in the real DT plane. Fortunately, all of the interesting features happen at real values, but there's no particular reason for that. Let's see if I can still do this. So let's see. There's the ABA curve, which is that T is one of the two golden ratios. So those are just horizontal lines in this plane. And then there's the G2 curve. So that was the G2 curve. And then finally, let me find another color of chalk. There's an SO3 curve as well, which here, which is a little bit terrifying to draw. Passes through there, and then does that.
Is the SO3 curve cross the first SO3 curve? Does it cross it, or is it like
over here? No, it's asymptotic. Yeah. I didn't actually look very carefully at the behavior of the thing. Okay. So what do we see on this crazy picture? There are these two points here where everything intersects in quite crazy ways, although at least transversely. And those are two different copies of this Fibonacci or golden category, or rather that category and its Galois conjugate. There's a special point here, which turns out to be on both the G2 and the SO3 curves. And it's SO3 in some 12th root of unity, or it's G2 with some other root of unity, I can't remember. And those categories mysteriously coincide, which I don't think anyone had noticed before, but it matters. And there's an interesting point here. This is the point where we see OSP21, that point on the SO3 curve that wasn't actually realized by SO3. There's a tangency between the two curves at that point. I would love to interpret this graph as telling us that there's a little deformation of the category OSP 2-1 near that point, but I don't know how to do that. Okay, that's a pretty picture. Let me see if there's a 30-second highlight I want to pull out of everything else. Maybe I'll just mention one more thing that just sort of completely got omitted in the bit that I did get to talk about today. If you remember going back to the earliest fib example, and we had this relation that said that we had a relation like this, and we said we could evaluate everything using a relation like that because we could just reduce the number of vertices. In general, the way that you prove those statements about we've discovered some relations and now we know how to evaluate actually uses versions of this discharging idea that was developed really for the four color theorem. So for example, a nice lemma is just that every planar trivalent graph, every closed planar trivalent graph, so no boundary, has a pentagon or smaller. Okay, and this is a very easy argument. Just if you give each n-gon in your graph 6 minus n dollars, it's very easy by doing an Euler characteristic count to see that there's a total of $12 out there. Okay, so now if you say, show me the money, if there's $12 in total, someone has a positive amount of money, and that implies that there was a face with n smaller than 6, so that 6 minus n was positive. That was easy. There's a better lemma that says you either see a bigon, a triangle, or a square, so those are much smaller than pentagons, or you see two pentagons adjacent to each other, or you see a pentagon adjacent to a hexagon. Okay, and you prove this in the same way. You give every n-gon 6 minus n dollars, so there's still $12 out there. You tell each pentagon, please divide your money equally into 20 cents, hand it to each of your neighbors. And then you say, show me the money, there's still a positive amount of money, and you quickly see that these are the only configurations that could have ended up with a positive amount of money after you do that arrangement. Now, the lemmas that we need to prove to make all this work turn out to be sort of modeled on these ones, but for open planar trivalent graphs, that is, one still with boundary, where instead we get to see that there's a pentagon or smaller, or some certain configurations near the boundary of the graph, and similarly more complicated ones like this that end up letting us do the evaluation algorithms. And I think that there is some interesting stuff in this paper about doing, this is called discharging, this general method, doing discharging locally on graphs with boundaries, I think something that we hadn't found anywhere else before. And turns out to give you a lot of mileage. Okay, I better stop.
Questions?
Yeah.
So it seems like in these blue boxes, there's kind of two pieces. One is writing down the polynomials, which cut out the varieties, and then there's a question of actually figuring out over which points you have categories.
Yes, so there's really three steps. There's one, you, by doing this stuff with varieties, you show that there aren't categories anywhere except on some certain places. Then you say you have to give an argument that says, if you're on one of these points, then there must somehow be enough relations in any category over one of those points so that you could have evaluated. That gives you at most one category over each one of those points, and then you hope that you've actually done enough work in the first step that every component of your variety is actually realized, and then the third step to go and actually realize every point that remains. Definitely the hard part is the hard part that's in this paper is the middle step. That is, once you're sitting at some point here, proving that merely having those values for those particular polyhedra that you've studied so far must imply that there's enough relations to evaluate is where really all the work goes. And unfortunately, we didn't really get to see that happening in the first example so much. The third part, realizing that at each one of these points there really is a category, is actually the hard part. But in this paper, we got to outsource all of that to other existing papers which show us these categories existing.
So if you wanted to go further up the left of the tree, which of these steps, is hopeless?
The reason why we stopped here and here was actually because the first step got too hard. Basically because Grobner bases suck. Actually, Grobner bases are great, and they're the only reason why it's possible to do the calculations here and here. You end up having to do it, to do this one. I mean, you need to do some really hairy calculations with some really horrible polynomials in several variables. You get an amazing answer, and there are just two points that get cut out at the end of the day, but you get to horrible situations where you can't even compute one of these determinants of a big matrix of inner products that you want because the matrix is too big and the polynomials in it are too big. But you've already, by looking at some of the earlier determinants, realized, oh, we're sitting over an elliptic curve. So we can do our calculations of that next determinant we need just over the elliptic curve that matters because of the things we've seen so far, and that calculation now becomes tractable. But on these branches, we're dead and probably forever dead without some better idea. So yeah, it's very sad, but I think these go extinct, but I don't know how to make any further progress in those directions. The thing to say is that sort of the state of the art before we tried doing all of this, people had thought about this exact subject, this exact question before, and they'd got here. So the methods do go quite a bit further. And really what we want to do in future, if we ever get back to this project, is not to extend those two graphs, but to do this again and very cheaply without much human input for categories generated by a tetravalent vertex or two different trivalent vertices or something else where we expect to hopefully pull up lots of examples quickly without trying to push too far in every basis direction.
Yeah. So with these, without the specific conditions, you still have k to the power polyhedra.
Yeah.
And so that's some big dimensional thing.
Yeah.
And you get all possible equations, right? So that makes sense. So do you have equations without dimension restrictions?
No. I don't think so. Yeah, you really, at the beginning of the day, is
so for each,
it's very hard to say anything about.
Okay, but for each family of dimension restrictions,
yeah,
you could say the dimension of C1 is less than 1,000, dimension of C2
yeah.
is less than
yeah.
3,
yep.
dimension of C3 could be anything we want, dimension
yep.
of C4,
yep.
then you get some variety in
yep.
this infinite dimensional thing.
Yep.
And as you relax them, so you get a family of varieties, as you relax the conditions,
yep.
it grows.
Yes.
and you would expect that most points on one of those varieties are not actually realized by a tensor category, is that right?
It's a bit hard to say it because I didn't get to setting up any, the language. But like for example, when we eventually cut down to the 2 points here, it ends up being 4 different determinants that we use all simultaneously vanishing, and sort of the first 3 of them still have lots and lots of components, which we got excited about and thought, wow, maybe we found an elliptic curve worth of tensor category sitting over there because it just won't die if you look at more and more determinants. But then eventually, much further on, it did. I'm not sure, I think that means it's not answering the question you asked. But,
it's also interesting.
Yeah. There were lots of, I mean, our initial versions of this graph for the higher cases had lots of extra components where we thought our job was to construct categories, and it was only much later that we realized that pushing a bit further in doing the Grabnik basis calculations, actually these promising components that seemed to survive many of the determinant calculations eventually died at some much bigger one.
Do you know of any examples? Which satisfies everything, but it still doesn't cover the tensor category.
We've got some open questions. So we did also a related version of this here at Geneva. I sort of just swept it under the rug. Here I didn't. In this talk, we were implicitly assuming that if you took a vertex and rotated it, it was the same as the vertex you started with, and I just failed to say that we were assuming that. Unfortunate, but you could also study pivotal categories where there was an eigenvalue, there was a cumulative unity there when you rotate. And we did this calculation in that case as well. Happily, things get actually a lot easier in this case. And there we find, I forget whether it's a point or a curve, I think just a few points where it survives a lot in this sort of cutting out variety sense. And we still don't know whether there's a category there. No one has answered that since we wrote the paper. People have been thinking about it. So yeah, we do have instances of points that survive everything we can throw out here, but we don't know the answer yet. But not in this setting. In this setting, we construct everything that survives.
Well, there's certainly no reason to expect that.
No.
Yeah. And if you have, like, suppose you have that nice picture there for some dimension restrictions. Is it possible that if you started relaxing the dimension restrictions a little bit for some values of k, that maybe some of those different irreducible components would actually lie on a single, say, irreducible surface in some higher dimensional space? Like,
yeah. Well, so that's the talk I gave a while ago, which was that over here. We have the category, the quantum version of the category representations of E6, which is some curve worth of tensor categories here. We've got E7 and some, conjecturally, there's this two-parameter quantum Deligne exceptional series, which would realize all of those. Which indeed does have bigger dimensions, and some you've got to go pretty far up before you see the dimensions exceeding any of these ones. But eventually, it does. Generically, the quantum exceptional series would have higher dimensions than any one of the actual exceptional series, and you'd see those curves fit together. But we don't. I mean, oh, of course, I mean, the example that does really work is just if you look at the quantum SLNs, each give you some curve, but then this Homfli category. This is now not in the trivalent setting, but you can use a braid instead of a crossing. When you see that, and again, this is up a little bit higher in dimension than any individual one of these.
I think the ones that do come from categories, do they form a variety? Or
sorry, the ones that
the if you look at the subset of k to the power polyhedra that come from, say, k's the complex.
That's a lovely. I have no idea. I mean, well, oh, yeah, let me think about that. Maybe, yeah, hopefully. it might be easy to, I mean, it's only going to be easy if the answer is no.
It might be easy if the answer is yes, or somehow you just slap equations on everything.
Okay.
Is it a union of, or?
Yeah, not sure. We better let you guys go, it's long after. If you feel like seeing the last two thirds of the talk, there are notes that are on my webpage that I just wrote this afternoon. Easier to be on the page, maybe.
Yes,
it's all
yeah, she's great
professional.
Yes. So we thought that as a very, very, very we checked that as long as the coverage wasn't too many people, we were not sitting
with it. I mean, that's G2 ratio. That prime is.